Hi viewers, hope you're all doing well. So today we will be starting a new series on virology, where we will be discussing about the origin and discovery of viruses, what is the basic structure of virus, what are the different parts in a virus like the capsid, the genetic material, the envelope, etc. We'll be looking at the replication cycles of virus and how the viruses can be purified and assayed after growing them. We'll also be touching upon a few important species or groups of viruses, some animal viruses, certain bacterial viruses and plant viruses. So let us begin this class on virology. Now initially all the diseases were thought to be brought about by bacteria because they were the ones that were discovered. It was assumed that all the diseases are being caused by bacteria. But there were a few scientists who worked with a disease called as tobacco mosaic disease, which is affecting the tobacco plants. And they discovered that no, it's not that the bacteria is causing the disease. There is another organism. There is another material that is causing the disease. So the first person who has done significant discovery in this towards this conclusion was Adolf Meyer. Now he was a German botanist who was studying the mottling disease or the mosaic disease of tobacco plants. What he did is that he took the sap or the infected juice of the tobacco plants and he has applied it onto healthy plants. When he did so, he realized that these healthy plants were being affected by the juice of that infected plant. So this means to say that whatever is causing the disease is transmitting or is present in that sap or is present in the juice of the infected plants. He also said that if this juice or the sap is heated above a temperature of 55 degrees Celsius, then that makes this juice ineffective. So heating was able to kill the element which was causing the disease. Then we had another scientist, that is Dmitry Ivanovsky. Ivanovsky found out that he also worked with the same disease. He found that when the infected sap was passed through a bacterial filter or a Chamberlain filter, it was still able to retain the capacity of infection. Which means to say that now in post thought, when we think about it, it means to say that the infection is being caused by an agent that is smaller than the bacteria. So he did not come about to this conclusion, but he did give us a very important point of note, that is the agent that is causing the tobacco mosaic disease is smaller than bacteria and is able to pass through the Chamberlain filter or the bacterial filter, which ideally should retain all the organisms. Instead, the agent was getting transmitted or it was passing through the filter and was getting collected in the filtrate. Then we had a very important scientist, Martinus Beijerinck, who in the year 1898 showed us, he also worked with the same disease. He showed us that the infective agent of tobacco mosaic disease is able to diffuse through the agar gel, but is not able to multiply in the agar, or it is not able to grow on a non-living substance like agar. For the agent to grow, for the agent to replicate or multiply, it needs a living cell to grow. So that was a very key aspect that Beijerinck told us. He said that these are entities which need a living cell to multiply, but they can survive outside the living cell. And he termed this agent as contagium vivum fluidum, which can be translated as soluble living germ. We now know that it's not a liquid that is causing the infection. It was actually a particulate matter. In fact, this was told to us, or this was brought about by another scientist who crystallized the virus. I'll come to it. So according to Beijerinck, the agent which was causing the tobacco mosaic disease was a liquid form, that is contagium vivum fluidum, and it was unable to replicate inside the or outside the living cells. It needed a living cell to grow. So he assumed that viruses were liquid in nature. But it was a very important conclusion that he gave us. Now in the year 1898, we also had two scientists, Loeffler and Frosch. They discovered that the agent which is filterable, which is able to, getting ineffective by heating, which is unable to survive or replicate outside a living cell, all these characteristics can also be contributed to an agent that causes a disease in animals, which was a foot and mouth disease. So they were the ones who discovered the first animal virus, that is a foot and mouth disease virus. This was by Loeffler and Frosch. We then had Walter Reed. Walter Reed told us in the year 1900 that it's not only animals and plants which are being affected by these viruses. We also have human beings which are being affected by virus. So it was the yellow fever virus which Walter Reed discovered in the year 1900. In the meantime, we had a lot of viruses being discovered. In fact, Bajerink even changed the terminology to virus instead of contagium vivum fluidum. And then the next major discovery was in the year 1915 when Frederick Wirt found out that viruses are not only infecting macroorganisms, they also infect bacteria. So he discovered viruses that attack bacteria. The very next year in 1916, it was Felix B. Herrill who gave us the terminology for viruses that attack bacteria. He called them as bacteriophage, or the viruses or something that eats up the bacteria. He also gave us the important concept about plaque assay. Now plaques are the areas that are formed on a bacterial plate when a virus affects it. So I grow a bacteria, then I add a viral suspension to it. When I add the viral suspension, the virus eats up the bacteria, and wherever it has eaten up the bacteria, there is an empty space. That empty space is called as a plaque. So that if you count the number of plaques, you can actually enumerate the number of viruses in a sample. This method is called as the plaque assay. We will be talking in detail about it later. And it was Felix D. Herrill who gave us the idea of a plaque assay. We also had another scientist in the year 1933, Schlesinger. He was a chemist. He gave us the chemical composition of a virus. He said that viruses are not like bacterial cells. They are just made up of a protein and a nucleic acid. So that concept that viruses are not cellular, they are just made up of certain chemical compounds, was given to us by Schlesinger. And in the year 1935, we have W.M. Stanley or Wendell Stanley who told us that viruses can be crystallized. They are particulate, they are made of protein, so they can very well be crystallized. He was the one who isolated or obtained the tobacco mosaic virus for the first time in a crystallizable form. After this, there were many more discoveries. In fact, during this time also, there were many new viruses that were discovered. We got the first electron micrograph of virus, which was again TMV. We had the scientists Salk and Sabin who were coming up with vaccines against viral diseases. They came up with vaccines for polio. So a lot of discoveries were done. And after this, the era of virology was established. The virology as a science was established. So during this time, there were many scientists who were arguing about the origin of viruses. Where did they come from? How did they arise? Were they present before bacteria? Were they co-evolving with the bacteria? So for this, there are several theories, but none of the theories have been completely accepted. The reason being, virus evolution or origin is very difficult to trace. The first reason being, they cannot be fossilized. They are so tiny and they are so delicate that you cannot obtain them as a fossil. They cannot go through the whole, the temperature changes, all the rigorous environment that happens when a fossilization takes place. They cannot go through that. So we don't have a viral fossil. We don't have, there are many viruses we know which have got integrated with their hosts. They were present, maybe they were present much before the bacteria, but they have got integrated with the bacterial chromosome. So that is another reason why we don't know or we cannot trace the origin of viruses. But of course now, due to a lot of sequencing studies, genome studies and the science of molecular systematics, we have been able to trace that this bacteria and this virus is related, or these two viruses are related, which can help us to trace the evolution of viruses completely. So there are three theories or hypotheses which explain the origin of a virus. The first being the virus first theory, regressive theory and progressive theory. Let us look at each of these theories in detail. So the virus first theory, like the name says, virus first component that could be even close to a living being was a virus. This is what it says. It says that viruses have evolved from complex molecules of protein and nucleic acids. They were the first ones. They were there in the pre-cellular era. They were the beings which were present always initially. They have existed before the cells have existed, before bacteria, before archaebacteria, before eukaryotes. So it says that viruses were the first components that were formed, and then we had evolution of a cell. Unlike the other two theories, the progressive and the regressive theories believe that before the virus existed, there were some cell and viruses evolved from there. But the virus first theory says that no, viruses were the first beings and then we had the cellular components coming from there. So it means to say that viruses existed in a pre-cellular world as self-replicating units. Now they didn't have a host, so they have to keep replicating and they were existing like that. What it means to say is that eventually these viruses or these self-replicating units got covered with a lipid layer, they got covered with certain other cytoplasm and then gave rise to the cell that we are seeing today. This is the one of the theories, that is the virus first theory or the virus first hypothesis. Now this has been dismissed by many scientists because it violates the definition of viruses. When we say virus, we say that it needs a host cell to replicate. But if you look at this theory, it means to say that viruses never needed a host. So due to that issue, this theory has been rebuffed by many of the scientists and they don't believe in it. We then have the progressive theory. Progressive theory can also be called as the escape hypothesis. So according to this escape hypothesis or progressive hypothesis, viruses are or were mobile genetic elements. Okay, they were genetic elements which were present in the DNA of the bigger organisms, or they were present as mRNA in the bigger organisms, and from there they have escaped. That is why it is called as an escape theory or a progressive theory. So this theory means to say that you had bigger organisms which had DNA and RNA in them, and bits of these DNA and RNA which could self-replicate have escaped when there was an unequal cell division. So during this unequal cell fission, there was a small vesicle that was formed. Into this small vesicle, a little bit of the self-replicating unit went in. When I say self-replicating unit, it could be self-replicating DNA or RNA. So the self-replicating unit went into the small vesicle during the asymmetrical or unequal cell fission. And after this, I had the formation of a cell which was able to mimic a bacterial cell or a prototype of a cell. So basically, viruses have arisen from, or they have escaped from, they were genetic elements which have become independent of their host cell. This is what the progressive theory says. Again, this theory is not explaining about the structures that are found only on the surface of viruses, the capsid proteins, the tegument proteins. Where have these arisen from? They are not present anywhere in the host cell. So it does not explain that, and due to which we have one more theory which is called as the regressive hypothesis or the regressive theory. Now in this theory, viruses were once small cells that had parasitized the larger cells. So they were present inside the larger cells as parasites, but along what it proposes is that they have arisen from the organisms like bacteria or from the other cells, and progressively they have lost the ability to multiply. So now they have become intracellular parasites, or they are dependent on their host for multiplication. Initially, they were part of a parasitic world. They were acting as parasites in bigger organisms, but now they have lost the ability to multiply. So this is the regressive theory. This also is not accepted fully, mainly because it does not explain why every small cellular parasite does not resemble virus in some way or the other. So that is the reason this is not accepted, but there are a lot of evidences for this theory because it has been found that there are a lot of giant viruses which are having similar genetic material to that of the parasitic bacteria. So what they mean to say there is that, look, the bacterial and the viral genome is similar, which means to say this was actually a bacteria earlier, but now with evolution, it has lost its ability to multiply independently and it is dependent on the host for multiplication. So this is the regressive theory. These are some of the theories which are explaining or trying to explain the origin of viruses. There are many more theories that are involved. Okay, now let us look at the properties of a virus. So when we say virus, when we talk about any particle as a virus, it has to conform or it has to fit into these properties. It should have these properties for us to properly call it as a virus. The first property is that they are acellular obligate intracellular parasites. They are acellular, which means to say that they don't have any cell-like organization. They are only made up of a protein coat and a piece of nucleic acid inside it, nothing more than that. So that is why we call it as acellular. They don't have any cell-like organization, no cell wall or cell membrane, nothing covering them, nothing, no components of a cell, they cannot multiply independently. So they don't have any cellular organization. Hence, we call them as acellular. They are obligate intracellular parasites. So when we say obligate and intracellular, it is having two terms over here. Obligate is compulsory and intracellular is within the cell, which means to say that viruses are compulsorily living inside a host cell. That is why they are parasites. They are taking the nourishment. They are using everything from the host cell. So they are obligate intracellular parasites. These viruses are ultra microscopic, which means to say their size is very small. They range from 20 to 300 nanometers maximum. And due to this, they can be viewed or visualized only with an electron microscope. We now have certain viruses like Pandora virus, or we have Megavirus chilensis, which was discovered quite recently. These are viruses which are having a much bigger size, Mimi virus. But then most of the viruses have a size ranging from 20 to 300 nanometers. They are having a genetic material of DNA or RNA, which means to say they cannot have both. It can either be a DNA virus or an RNA virus. It cannot have both the materials. Unlike in our cells, where even if DNA is a genetic material, we do have RNA in the form of mRNA, tRNA, rRNA. But viruses lack that. They can either have DNA or RNA, never both. These viruses are sensitive to a lot of agents like heat, UV, ether. There are oxidizing agents. So all of these, especially the enveloped viruses, are very, very sensitive to these agents, and they can be made ineffective by applying these agents. Viruses, we know, are crystallizable. This has been shown to us by Stanley. So they can be crystallized and they are filterable through the bacterial filters. They can be passed through the bacterial filter. Bacterial filter will not retain them. Viruses have two phases. One is an extracellular phase, which is known as the virion. It does not show reproduction. And the other one is the intracellular phase, which means within the cell, wherein the virus is able to multiply using the host machinery. So these are some of the properties of viruses. In the next class, we'll be looking into what are the modes of replication of a virus, how are the viruses cultivated, what are the methods of cultivation of viruses, and what are the different methods of assay and purification of virus. I hope this class was useful for all of you. See you in the next class. Bye.